Hey guys, so today we'll talk about Euler's identity. And it's really important in mathematics because it ties together five of the most important numbers that we have. E, I, pi, 1, and 0. Now, some people will say that his name is Euler, but I also pronounce it JIF, so I don't care, sue me. Now, let's look at what E really is. It's an infinite non-repeating number, just like pi. It starts with 2.71828 and so on and so forth. But there's also very many other definitions. Some of the most popular ones are right here. It can be represented as an infinite limit as n goes to infinity. It can also be presented as an infinite sum of factorials. And another important thing in math is that e to the x is a derivative of itself, which is very critical. That's why it's called the natural number of growth, the natural log of growth in right here, ln. And usually, as you may already know, if we take the derivative of an exponential function, this is the derivative, logarithm times the actual function. Now, let's look at my favorite example, the one going back to the limit as n goes to infinity, to intuitively really understand what it means. Now, with this example, let's imagine that I'm a bank. And I'm the best bank in the world because I offer you 100% interest per year, which is unbelievable, as you know. And you come to me and you give me a dollar, right? And now I give you the option of how often you want to collect that interest. If you just do it once, you'll get 100% after a year. So you'll get $2 after the year right here, which makes sense. But you can also do it twice. If you were to do it twice, you would collect interest first time after 6 months. And then again after 6 months. So that would be 1.5 times 1.5. So at the end of the year, you would have $2.25. So what's the pattern here? Let's say you do it three times. So every 4 months, you would collect 33% interest. So it would be 1.33 times 1.33 times 1.33. So at the end of the year, you would have $2.35. All right, let's keep going. So let's say you do it 10 times, like the green line here. What would you have at the end of the year? It would be 1.1 to the 10th power. So you would have $2.59. So if you do this infinitely, if you collect interest all the time, like literally every nanosecond, you would have E dollars at the end of the year. That's the magic number. Now let's go on to what is I, the imaginary unit? Now the classical textbook definition is that it is the solution to the quadratic equation x squared plus 1 equals 0, or in other terms, I is just the square root of negative 1. But that's, I don't know, I don't think that's simple enough to explain it. So let's try another approach. Now, the way that we're always taught numbers is we have an infinite number line that goes from minus infinity to plus infinity. And every number that you've ever heard of is on this line somewhere. You have pi, you have 1,000, I don't know, minus 723, whatever. Any number that you can think of is somewhere over here. But that's really not the best way to think about numbers. So here's the example that I like to use. If you're the guy running along the plane here, you're running along the real numbers, and perpendicular to you is the imaginary numbers, which, by the way, imaginary is not a really good word, I think, because they're not imaginary, they exist, but it's hard to picture them in our everyday life, so I guess that's why they call them imaginary. So if you're moving in this direction, and we want to say that you want to run the complete opposite direction, we would multiply your speed by minus one, right? And that would just flip you, and you would go the other way. But now, what if we want to say we don't want to flip you 180 degrees, we just want to flip you at a 90 degree angle. So all we would do is multiply you by I. And why does that make sense? Why is it going back to I is the square root of minus 1? Because if we multiply you by I twice, it's the same as multiplying by minus 1. Because the first time we multiply by I, you're now running vertically. But if we multiply you by I again, you rotate by 90 degrees and now you're going in this direction. So I think that's really an intuitive way to understand why I is the square root of minus 1 with this example right here. And it's really important because when we get into like more in-depth mathematics like statistical dynamics or electromechanics and even quantum physics, I mean, complex numbers are everywhere, imaginary numbers, if you will, but complex numbers is a better choice of words. All right, now let's keep going. This is also Euler's identity, but more generalized. And really to understand why this equation is true, we need to know about Taylor series, which is a topic for another lecture. But if we take a look at the unit circle, and we have our two axes, imaginary and real, and we draw our angle here, phi, then we have two values here. We have the cosine of the angle of the unit circle, and we have the sine. And if we multiply the sine by I in the previous example, then we know that it's going upwards, right? So that makes sense. Now, finally, to show that Euler's identity is true, we just plug in pi into the equation. So I to the power, e to the power of I pi equals cosine pi plus I times sine pi. And as we already know, cosine of pi is negative 1, and sine of pi is 0. So I times 0 is 0. So we're just left with minus 1. So e to the I pi equals minus 1. And then if we just carry it over to get the positive 1, we have e to the I pi plus 1 equals 0. There you go. Now you're as smart as Euler, and you can start wearing his cool hat.
Hope you guys enjoyed this video. For more economics topics, click here. Don't forget to subscribe.